All right, welcome to Weather Talk. We're doing something really cool here.
Yeah.
We are live on the Weather Talk Facebook page.
Never done this before.
As we record
the podcast.
The Weather Talk podcast.
Yes, the podcast right there if you can see.
How
probably
cool
not.
Is this? And you get a special treat if you're watching this on Facebook on this test run.
Yeah.
That is Triple D.
This is the
never
mug.
Never before.
No.
Has Dust Devil Dave.
Mother's never seen me before. This will be the first time she's ever actually laid eyes on me.
It's the first time.
Hi, Mom.
That Triple D has made a public appearance.
Yes.
You are the international man of mystery, and now everybody knows.
Well, now my cover's blown.
Your cover is blown.
Now I got to shave and grow my hair out.
You just use your regular name now.
Yeah, I'm Phil.
Phil, you're still going to go undercover.
Phil. Yeah.
All right, so this is kind of cool, right? We're live
on
Facebook. We're recording the podcast. If you're a fan of our Facebook page, obviously I hope that most of the people have listened to the podcast.
If you're watching.
Before, but now you get to see how we do it, how we record it, where we do it from. This is the broadcast radio, one of the three broadcast studios that are at WBAL Radio,
yeah.
Right?
This is the backup of the backup studio. So if something happens in the main studio, we'd rush down here, which is
right on
the other side of the building from
the
main studio.
They put us in the
yes.
backup of the backup of the backup.
Yes.
That's where Weather Talk belongs.
If you listen to WBAL, which you should have been doing, about a year ago, we
right.
broadcasted out of this studio while the new studio was being built.
And the new studio is gorgeous.
It's
I mean,
beautiful.
Hopefully one of these days we're going to get to go live from the big, big studio.
Yes.
We'll kick everybody out. And
they'll invite us in over
they'll
there.
They'll invite us into the big, big studio. But this one is still nice.
So. I like it.
And I think people like to see a behind-the-scenes, you know, look, what everything appears behind the scenes. This is what our radio studio looks like. It's not what a TV studio looks like, but we'll do that.
We don't need it to
day.
Be TV because it's radio.
We're going to go on TV. We're going to do radio
we're
on TV
there.
One of these days. All right, so I'm Tony Pan, in case you haven't figured that out yet. And we're going to have a little fun today and talk about things that weathercasters like me say on TV every day that nobody knows what we're talking
about.
They
confuse people like me
right.
all the time.
So weather terms that we use all the time that people have a hard time understanding or even knowing what we're talking about. And I posted this on Facebook and on Twitter, and I got a great response.
Yeah, I saw
from
that.
People had all kinds of terms, and I
oh,
had
yeah.
a few in my head, but I had no idea some of these terms that people didn't know
yeah,
what we were talking about.
They were crazy. I loved it.
So now you're in the news business.
So far, so good.
So far, so good. And you've probably heard these terms over and over again. And
yes.
I would venture, and again, if you've listened to the podcast before, I really don't discuss what we're going to talk about with Dave beforehand.
No, he likes to surprise me.
I like to surprise you. I would guess that even you, somebody who's been in the business
yes.
and around weather people, don't know what a lot of these terms are.
Bring it.
All right, here we go.
Ready and waiting.
All right, here, I'm just going to, this is in no particular order, and I'll hit all of them. Dew point. Heat index. Instability. Backdoor cold front.
Backdoor cold front?
Backdoor cold front.
That one's new.
What does it mean when the atmosphere is capped? Somebody wants to hear about derechos.
Of course, that one's a big one. That's
and
a big one.
I didn't even pronounce it the right way. I actually wrote down the actual pronunciation.
It's not pronounced derecho?
It's de-re-cho. That's how you're supposed to.
That's difficult.
De-re-cho. I think I was adding an extra syllable in there.
No.
Convection. The high temperature and low temperature for the day. People don't really understand what that means.
Everyone knows what a high temperature is.
I know, but I'm going to show you. I'm going to talk about something that you may not think about.
There's more to it.
About high and low pressure. And
okay.
then somebody brought up microburst because we were talking about microburst with the storms the other day.
Yeah, I like that's a good one.
And the percentage, and we discussed this on the podcast before. The percentage underneath the symbol on the 7-day, 30% chance. For
oh
rain,
yeah, the percentage 40%, of yes.
What does that mean? And I think a lot of these are good. So I'm going to start with dew point.
Okay, yeah, because that one comes up a lot.
We talk about the dew point on almost every weathercast in the summer. And people are always asking me, why don't you just say relative humidity?
Which is another one that's relatively confusing.
I think, and that the reason we use dew point is because it's less confusing than relative humidity. Now, the dew point is the temperature at which you would have to lower an air mass temperature to get water to condense out of it. For example, if the air temperature is 90 and the dew point is 75, you would have to cool that air mass down to 75 degrees to get water to come out of it.
Okay.
Hence the term dew, like you would see dew on the grass.
Dew on your grass, yes.
Okay, so
that's
like
how I was
very often
it out.
Overnight, especially in the fall and early spring, temperature gets down to the dew point and the water condenses out on the grass and we see dew out there. That's the dew point, okay? So, for example, if the temperature is 90 and the dew point is 75, that's really sticky. That's uncomfortable.
Yeah, higher dew point means it's uncomfortable,
exactly.
Correct?
Exactly. The closer the dew point is to the actual temperature, the more humid it is. So 90 over 75, bad. 90 over 55,
good.
See, there you go. So the lower the dew point, the more comfortable you feel. In contrast, relative humidity is a percentage. So a lot of people don't like to do math. I don't like to do math either.
Never do math on the radio, man. It never works out well for us.
So the reason it can be misleading is if you have a temperature of 90 and a dew point of 75, the relative humidity might only be 55 or 60%. You might go, that's not that bad. But in reality, you feel awful when you go outside.
It feels bad.
In contrast, if the temperature is 50 and the dew point is 49, the relative humidity might be 95%. You would think, oh my God, I'm going to feel awful when you go outside, and you don't feel that
through
bad.
Soup.
So that's why we use dew point as opposed to relative humidity.
I can see why it's less confusing.
I hope it's a little
slightly
less confusing. All right, let's go on to another one. Heat index.
Yes, what is the heat index?
We use that all the time in the summer.
Why would you use it in the winter, Tony?
Because we use wind chill. It's the same concept.
Opposite
wind chill and heat index are the same concept. It all has to do with the moisture on your skin, believe it or not.
Oh, okay.
Why do you sweat? I know why you sweat, because I'm sweating.
Because
I'm
I was going to say, I'm sitting here underneath these lights and the camera's on me.
You would do awful on TV. I sweat a lot on TV, too.
Thanks.
The studio, if the temperature is not like 60 degrees in the studio, boiling sweat.
I keep my studio dark and cold.
And this is why I like hanging out with you. But the reason that we sweat is so that the water can evaporate off of your skin.
Yeah, cool
it
you
takes
off.
Heat energy to evaporate water. And that heat energy is taken from the surface of your skin. That's why you feel cool when you get out of the pool or the shower.
Okay.
Because the water evaporating off of your skin is taking heat energy from the surface of your skin so you feel cooler. Now, if the dew point is really high, that process can't take place because there's so much moisture in the air. The sweat can't evaporate off of your skin. That's why you feel hotter, and that's why we say the heat index is, the temperature might be 90, but the heat index is 105. There's an actual formula that we use to calculate how sweaty you are and how much of that moisture is evaporating off of your skin.
Is this why I see you guys send the intern out to run around the parking lot a few times? They come back in and you scrape off the sweat?
You're reading my mind.
I look out the window and see these things. I wonder why now. I know.
So it has to do with sweat, okay?
Wait, do you do the calculations on a pencil and paper? Like, do you sit down and then you put your thinking cap on?
No, I'm not calculating anything.
You got the text instrument calculator?
That. Wind chill is the exact opposite, okay? So if the air is really dry like it typically is in the winter, there's more evaporation going off of your skin. And you're getting colder faster because the moisture is evaporating off of your skin because of the cold, dry air.
Oh, okay.
So you feel colder. So the wind chill is the calculation of how fast that's coming off of your skin as well, but it's the exact opposite as the heat index.
Makes sense to me.
I hope that sounded reasonable.
Yes.
Okay. The next one, instability.
Well,
now,
who
I'm
are
not
we talking?
Mental
we
instability
talking here? Oh,
because,
okay, good.
You know, that would we would be
concerned
both,
if this was an intervention
culpable I'm
wondering
that.
What's going on.
Instability and convection, those two terms go together, and we use them, and I'm guilty of it all the time using those two terms on TV, and a lot of people don't know what it means. Now when I brought this up to you before we did the show, convection, you thought of your oven,
the oven,
right?
We have a convection oven.
You have a convection oven. It's the same thing in the atmosphere. It's rising motions in the atmosphere, just like in your oven. You heat it up, and the air goes up, and then it curls back down like that. So convection is the result of instability, and instability is a measure of the rising motions in the atmosphere.
Okay.
That's how you get thunderstorms. You got to have air going up, right?
Yes.
So an unstable atmosphere is one where there's a lot of rising motions, and the convection is the thunderstorms that develop as a result of the instability.
Oh, okay.
So convection is actually just another term for thunderstorms or clouds.
Oh, it's a scientific term?
Yeah. So there you go. Instability creates the convection that we talk about on TV.
Okay.
And instability is just rising motions in the atmosphere. Another one that I thought was kind of interesting is in relation to the high and low temperature.
Okay.
All right.
So, okay. Yes.
So when I say on TV, and I just casually do, and a lot of weathercasters do, it's going to be 85 today. What do you think?
Oh, it's going to be 85 from the warmest part of the day, which is, I think, 2 to 4 o'clock, 2 to 5 o'clock in this area-ish.
Right.
I think, oh, it's going to be 85 for a few hours.
At least a few hours,
you
right?
plan for 85.
In reality, the high temperature for the day, most days, is only a couple of minutes.
So I put on the shorts for a few minutes. That's
great. When we hit 100, what was it, on Saturday?
Yeah.
Over the weekend? Remember we hit 100?
Oh, I remember. I was
moving.
It was
only 100 for like 2 minutes.
Oh,
and yet, we
report
it as the high temperature for the day, and that's true.
You advertise it. You got to give me more than a couple minutes.
All day. As a matter of fact, it was in the 90s most of the day.
Oh, you got to say that.
I know. We're misleading, aren't we?
That is false advertising. I want my money back.
Same thing goes with the low temperature. If I say the low temperature is going to be 10, it might only be 10 for 15 minutes.
Yeah, and usually the low temperature is in the morning, right?
Right before sunrise.
Yeah, right before sunrise. So most people aren't even awake and out of the door yet.
So I get what you're saying, that it's a little misleading. But just know that when I say it's going to be 90, it's not going to be 90 all day. It might be 85 for most of the day or 86.
Oh,
and that 90 might only be achieved for like 1 minute.
What they need to do is follow you on Twitter, and you will give hour by hour temperatures. And you will say, we have reached the top. And now we're trending back down.
And that would be more accurate.
Yes.
Actually. But
follow Tony on Twitter.
Way too long on TV because they only give me 2 minutes to talk
about. Yeah. And they're not going to want to crawl underneath Days of Our Lives.
No way, man. Not Days of Our Lives.
No, don't mess up Days.
All right. So another, just, again, these are in no specific order. Backdoor cold front.
You know.
I'm going to put a gag order
I've
on you.
I've never heard this before. I'm going to let the professional handle this.
All right. So a backdoor cold front is a term that's used mostly just on the East Coast and the Mid-Atlantic. Typically, weather, and we've talked about this on the podcast before, weather systems go from west to east, right?
Yes.
Typically. So most cold fronts come in from the west or northwest and then sweep in here.
Okay.
Occasionally, there's a cold front that comes in from the northeast. Think about where we are in Baltimore. Think of New England.
Yeah.
The cold front would come in almost from the opposite direction, from the northeast or the east, and sweep into Baltimore.
Okay.
And so because it's a rare thing that it comes from that direction, we call it, we say it came in through
the back door.
Thank you.
Wow. Now I want a graphic, and I want Chiron.
You want all that stuff.
I want notifications.
So that's why we say backdoor cold front. It's not that it's anything special. It's just a cold front, but it's just coming from a direction.
So you're just jazzing it up.
I'm just jazzing it up a little
bit. All
right. The other thing, somebody said, I heard you say once on TV that the atmosphere is capped.
Yes, I've heard this as well. I was curious.
It's kind of a weird thing to say on TV, and probably weathercasters shouldn't do it because it's kind of a technical term.
Okay.
But it sounds cool to say the atmosphere is capped, right?
Yeah, I envision like high clouds that don't let anything out.
But that's kind of what it is.
Hey, I was right.
Okay?
Kind of.
In order to have instability, rising motions in the atmosphere,
yes,
you got to have cool air on top of warm air.
Okay.
Because the warm air ascends towards the cool air. It like shoots up into the cool air.
Yeah.
If the atmosphere is stacked in such a way that the temperature is almost the same going from the surface up to like 5 or 10,000 feet.
Okay.
There's no instability created there.
Mm-hmm.
So we say it's capped.
Oh.
There's no cool air on top of the warm air to create the instability.
Gotcha.
So we say there's a cap on top of the atmosphere. Now, you can still get thunderstorms in those kinds of situations, but you need something called a kicker. You need something to get...
What would be an example of a kicker?
The kicker would be like a cold front coming through.
Like a backdoor cold front.
Or a backdoor cold front. Something that forces the air up on its own.
Okay.
Not instability-wise, where you just have the cool air on top of the warm air. You need something to get it going up. So when we say the atmosphere is capped, that's what we mean by that. Derecho.
This is a big one in this area because, what was it, 5 years ago?
2012.
Okay.
We had that one come through with wind gusts, 89. Yeah. Everybody around here remembers the derecho.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you have your own personal story with the derecho. I mean, everybody's got one. Okay, so what is it? What is a derecho?
Because, and I want to stop you because you say what it is. Every time we get a bad thunderstorm, inevitably, someone says, it was a derecho.
It was a derecho, right.
Derecho gets blamed on for everything.
And that's because it's become, at least around Baltimore, into the public consciousness.
The lexicon.
The lexicon. Thank you. That's why I have you here for big words. Lexicon. I took my glasses off to make myself look smart, you know, but then you came up with the
correct. Set me up for it. Thank you.
All right. So a derecho is a line of thunderstorms. Think of it if we stacked individual thunderstorms up in a Boeing fashion, like a semicircle.
Okay.
That's typically what they look like. And they travel together. They're individual thunderstorms, but they travel together in that line. And there is a technical definition for it to be called a derecho.
Okay.
It has to hold itself together for 240 miles. So it can't be just a cluster of thunderstorms that develops in Western Maryland and then comes over towards Baltimore, because that's not far enough by the technical definition. It has to hold itself together for 240 miles, and it has to be consistently producing wind gusts over 58 miles per hour to be called a derecho. Here, we had wind gusts 80, 90 miles per hour.
Oh, wow.
I mean, that's significant.
Yes.
All right. And this leads me to the other term that somebody asked about, microbursts.
Another big one we've gotten recently.
Because we were talking about that with the thunderstorms that came through. We're recording this on Wednesday, July the 24th.
Yeah.
So just a couple of days ago, we had the big thunderstorms with microburst winds of 75 miles per hour. They were chasing you home the other night.
They were. In front of me, bright blue skies. Behind me, dark clouds. And I said, hey, can we just pick up the pace a little bit?
Yeah, you don't need to be a weather person to know that it's coming to get you. You should drive faster, right?
When there are dark clouds behind you, move faster.
So a microburst is... Remember we talked about on the podcast, thunderstorms have updrafts and downdrafts in
them.
Okay. So a microburst is a really strong downdraft coming out of the base of the thunderstorm that is almost in tube fashion. If you remember, if you can visualize a tube of air shooting down the bottom of the thunderstorm, out of the base of the thunderstorm, and then spreading out on the ground after it hits.
Okay.
Okay. So that's a microburst. And these microbursts can be, and often are, worse than the weaker tornadoes. I mean, I think it's more significant when you get a microburst of 70, 80 miles per hour than an EF0 tornado or even an EF1 for this reason. A tornado might only be a half a mile across or a few yards across.
Okay.
It's a spinning vortex and it's very violent, but it would only affect just a small area, right?
Yes.
A microburst could affect an area 5 miles wide or 10 miles wide.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so it's like a plow hitting the ground and going out.
Okay.
And that's why when we were on the air doing the tornado warnings the other night.
Yes, I remember this.
I was saying on the air, it doesn't matter if there's a tornado in here. I'm seeing microburst winds of 75 miles per hour, which is technically even worse. So it didn't matter if there was a tornado in there or not, because a lot of times when the Weather Service issues a tornado warning, it's not like somebody sees the tornado.
Yeah.
Most of the time, it's what we call radar indicated. We can see the rotation in a thunderstorm, right?
Yeah.
So whether there was one or there wasn't one, it didn't matter. You should have still gone to the basement, because I was talking about microbursts, right?
Now, is it easier to see tornadoes and predict tornadoes than it is to predict microbursts?
I would say no.
Okay.
I would say it's easier to predict that a storm would or could have the potential to create a strong microburst than to create a tornado. Tornadoes are very complicated things.
Mm-hmm.
We're not very good yet at predicting them in advance. We can say that the conditions are there, all the ingredients are there, but all these ingredients have to come together in such a way, in such a perfect way, to create the vortex, the spinning vortex.
Okay.
So I think it's easier to look at a thunderstorm and say, hey, there could be a microburst in there of 75 miles per hour.
Gotcha. So there's a better potential for microbursts in every thunderstorm than there are for tornadoes?
Yes, I would say that is true.
Okay.
All right. So before I go on, anything you can think of off the top of your head, because I know I've covered a lot here, that we say on TV that really gets your goat?
Relative humidity was one that confused me, or is you know, I was curious about.
Right.
No, I think
you think we covered it
you
all?
Got
okay,
em.
Just one more thing before we, I'm going to go on and do a quick weather forecast here for the rest of July.
But I'll walk around here then.
Yeah, no, you've had enough?
I'll let you do the thing. I'll be over here.
All right, you'll be over here. All right, the severe weather outlook that we put on, you know, when we paint the map yellow and we say in this yellow area, there's a chance for severe weather, the Storm Prediction Center, and they have all these different categories, marginal, slight, moderate, high, you know. I know it's confusing to the public. And basically what we're saying is inside those areas, there's at least the possibility that you could experience severe weather. But I want to point this out. For example, if we say there's a tornado watch in effect, there's a very small probability that your house is actually going to get hit with a tornado.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean you shouldn't be prepared for it. But in reality, most of the time around here, it's a 2 to 5% chance that any one location will be hit by a tornado. So I know it sounds scary when you see all this stuff on TV and like the network say, 21 million people are under the threat for severe weather. You know,
it's a lot of people.
It's true. Okay, there's a wide area that is under the threat. But the reality is that you have a very small chance of actually experiencing a tornado in most instances. I would say the highest probability is about 10 or 15%, even in the worst case scenarios around here. And most of the time, it's 2 to 5%. So I hope that makes you feel a little better and less scared when something like this is going on. It doesn't mean, you know, that you shouldn't prepare.
Don't ignore the warnings.
Right. I'm not saying that. I'm saying there is, in reality, a very low probability that you would experience severe weather personally in regards to being hit by a tornado.
But still, when you hear the EAS, when you hear Tony say there's
a chance.
Go to the
basement anyhow, yes.
Just be safe.
Just be safe.
It doesn't hurt to be safe. They don't go on for hours. It's only
generally 20 minutes.
Yeah, usually 20 minutes. You can go sit in the basement with your family and play Uno
exactly.
for 20 minutes.
Exactly. So, just wanted to cover that one. All right, so I think I've heard them all. If you have one and you're watching on Facebook or you're listening to this later, you got one that you want me to discuss, I will happily do it. I'll write back to everybody.
Write back. We can touch on it in another episode.
All right, just a quick look ahead. The pattern for the rest of July into August, I don't see any big heat waves coming. It's going to get close to 90 for a couple of days, but there's not going to be a stretch like we just had. I see a lot of instances where the air mass changes a lot going into the beginning of August. So don't look for any extended periods of 90, 100 degree temperatures like we just had. It's going to get hot for a couple of days, but there'll be fronts coming through. At least that's the way it looks, a progressive pattern over the next couple of days.
When can we expect the snow train?
I can already hear it in the distance.
All right.
I can hear it in the distance. It won't be long now. All right, let's take a question from the internet. Though.
Question from the internet, which if you'll notice now on, you know, you can see us on Facebook Live.
Can I actually just write it down?
Yeah. I read the question from the internet off of a piece of paper that Tony gives to me.
And you thought we were more sophisticated than that.
We're not looking at internet questions off the internet. It's a piece of paper.
Yeah.
Tim, off the Weather Talk Facebook page where you can watch us right now.
Yep.
How do they know if a tornado hit or if it was something else?
Okay, so when a storm comes through and there's a report of damage,
yes,
the Weather Service will send a crew out to that area, and they will assess whether it was straight-line winds, a microburst, or if it was a tornado. And the way they can tell is by the direction of the damage.
Okay.
For example, if all the trees were pushed over in the exact same direction, it was most likely a microburst.
Okay.
If some of the trees go this way, some of the trees go this way, in other words, they detect a
rotation, spinning
motion in the debris, then they can say it's a tornado. So that's how they do it. They look at the debris that's on the ground and the direction in which it fell, and most of the time it's trees.
Yeah.
If it's all going the same direction, it was probably a microburst. If there's a little...
Now, do they take people's accounts into...
Sure, of course.
Okay, so if someone says, I saw what looked like a tornado came down, then...
They will take it into account for sure. And a lot of people have video and pictures now, too.
Yeah.
You know? Everybody's doing that. All right, so this is going to wrap up this edition of the Weather Talk Podcast,
our first one
live on Facebook. If you are watching, I want to thank you for watching. I appreciate it. And if you're listening later, you can go back and look at this video because I think they're going to post it all over the place.
Probably.
on the WBAL radio Facebook page and maybe even on the TV page. We're going to try to get this.
You handle that, I'll handle the radio side.
All right, I'll do TV, you do radio, just like we always do. All right, for Triple D, Dust Devil Dave, this is Tony Pan signing off. Have a good one. We'll talk to you next week.